Mike Danna is back in Kansas City as we all hoped, expected. Let's talk about it.
This is KC Sports Network, proudly presented by M-Prize Bank.
The breaking news team has assembled, and for now it is just me here. What's up, everybody? Kent Swanson here. Breaking news team potentially coming here shortly, but we're celebrating the news that Mike Danna is back in Kansas City. He has signed a three-year deal to remain with the Kansas City Chiefs after the L'Jarius Sneed news came out. I think there was a lot of expectation, and there's some reports that some, you know, that Mike Danna was probably going to be coming back to Kansas City. They have officially agreed to a deal, and it's not just a one-year deal. This is a three-year contract that the Chiefs have given out to Mike Danna to bring him back to Kansas City. Nate Taylor, you can hear him on Only Weird Games. You heard him yesterday on Only Weird Games. Mike Danna and the Chiefs have agreed to a three-year, $24 million contract that includes $13 million guaranteed. A source confirmed to The Athletic, Mike Garofalo had it first, but I believe Nate's the first one I've seen have numbers. So good on Nate. Nate also has tweeted out, as expected, several teams pursued Mike Danna, who was a first-time unrestricted free agent. Danna, similar to Chris Jones, made re-signing with the Chiefs his top priority. So another guy that the Kansas City is bringing back to, that wanted to be here, was part of this culture, wanted to be part of this winning culture. And now they've signed a guy who they drafted, they developed as a day three player and brought him back to a place that fits his game perfectly. You know, there was obviously, I'm sure, a market for Mike Danna. Some people thought it was going to be a little bit higher even than this when it was all said and done. The longer that Mike Danna was available, the more it felt likely that there was a chance that the Chiefs were going to be able to get back into the mix for his services. And when L'Jarius Sneed left, that obviously opened up some flexibility for this team to do a lot of different things, across their roster. I love that this is a three-year deal. I think part of the downside of doing one-year deals with players, there's multiple things, right? You're not keeping them for more than 1 year. There's really not a ton of upside from a longevity perspective. It's a contract year for those players, which is a good thing on the front side of, hey, look, you're going to get this best version of this guy because he's out there trying to get his money. But you don't have as much cap flexibility when you're doing a lot of 1 year deals, and you don't have the sustainability of having a guy for more than one season. So being able to get him on a 3 year deal, I think, is awesome. This is a guy that knows this system, that knows this defense, that is loved by this coaching staff, that does all the little things that you want out of a defensive end in a Steve Spagnuolo defense. He's not the gaudiest stats, although, I mean, he had 6.5 sacks this season. He set a career high in sacks, QB hits, and tackles. He had a great contract year, but he also does so many little things for this team that you've got to appreciate it. And the Chiefs appreciate him. They gave him $13 million guaranteed, $8 million APY to keep one of their own. This is a pretty well-rounded defensive end group now. You've got a lot of different flavors of guys. You've got good bodies. You don't necessarily have to worry about Charles Omenihu coming back because you've brought Mike Danna back into the mix. You're going to look at George Karloftis, Mike Danna, Malik Herring, Felix Anudike-Uzomah. You're rolling out. You can roll those four out, right now comfortably and be fine. So, that's a good group that they've got here. And I think they could be done. I think, we've talked about Darius Robinson potentially as an option at the edge position for the Chiefs in round one. That seems less likely now. It seems less likely because the Chiefs have kind of rounded out their edge group. Sure, you can always get greedy and you can always continue to add more pass rushers, and you can never have enough pass rushers. But here we are, Mike Danna back on a three-year deal for the Kansas City Chiefs. We will take some questions. We'll take some thoughts from you guys, kind of looking at some of these, comments that are out there. we're seeing Grayson Jasper saying it's a 2-year deal with a 3-year option. So I'm going to kind of keep an eye on some of these numbers here, see if I can kind of confirm that. But I mean, the big number is that the Chiefs gave him $13 million in guaranteed money. So he's got some guaranteed cash. And this is a guy that has not had a payday. This is a guy that's not been paid yet because, as a rookie, Grayson said he was guessing. Okay. Well, I don't know, Grayson, maybe not throw that in there next time. Craig is great though. But yeah, this is a guy that's not been paid yet. He hasn't had a chance to earn that money. He hasn't had a chance to get any kind of payday whatsoever. You know, he's been, making very minimal for NFL standards. And here we go. He gets his payday. This is going to be great. And this will lower, this doesn't preclude the Chiefs from doing anything at all in 2024 either, because the way a 3-year, $24 million deal, that means you've got 3 years to spread those cap hits around. So he's going to have, he's going to have his guaranteed money. I'm sure he's going to have a signing bonus attached to it, but it's going to probably be a low cap hit in 2024 with escalations in 25 and 26. So this, if you still wanted to go out and do a 1-year deal with some kind of player, if you wanted to go try it, if there's something that pops up that gives you an opportunity, you haven't lost really any flexibility. The Chiefs had a little over $25 million in cap space heading into this move. The cap hit for 2024, it's probably going to be $3-4 million. It's not going to be that much at all. So, everything's still on the table for the Chiefs. Jonas Samuel asks, do you think that's the last signing until the draft? I don't think so. No, I think the Chiefs will continue to try to look at some of these options out here. I think they'll continue to try to find ways to make, to make this roster better. Any other internal moves, I could see them continue to try to bring back some of those kind of guys, that were on last year's team. One thing I am paying attention to, though, and this could preclude them from making some moves, is they might be playing the compensatory formula game just a little bit, because we're less than 3 weeks now from the NFL draft. And once the NFL draft is complete, basically all free agents don't count against the compensatory formula. So like I saw someone bringing up an Odell Beckham Jr. As a guy that maybe the Chiefs, go and grab him on a 1-year deal, ring chasing. DJ Beagler asked that. If the Chiefs wait until after the draft, they aren't going to count against the compensatory formula. So you're going to get those, what I think they're currently slated for two comp picks right now. And honestly, that's probably about it. That's another thing that's probably worth talking about. There's really not a ton of players at this point that the Chiefs have out there on their that were on their roster last year that would potentially count against the compensatory formula. I think Danna was actually their next best chance of acquiring a decent compensatory pick. Honestly, like that was the one. So bringing him back on a long-term deal, this is great. I love it. I'm not complaining. This isn't complaining about the compensatory pick or anything like that. They're probably capped at the two that they're going to get. And there's really not a ton of players that are probably going to draw anything. I think Donovan Smith's probably back at some point. That might be an after the draft signing, but that has nothing to do with the compensatory formula. You know who else has nothing to do with the compensatory formula? Ryan Scott Hall. Ryan. Back. How are you?
I'm doing real good, man. A lot better now that Mike Danna's back in the fold.
It's so great, man. I'm so excited. And we've got even more people coming in here. Matthew Lane is in the building as well. Hello, Matthew. Hey.
It's Danna time. 3 years. What's up, guys? How we doing?
Did you just go get a haircut?
No, it hasn't been 29 days.
Oh, okay. My bad. Ryan, you got in here first and you've earned it. I want to know, what's your just initial thoughts on the Mike Danna signing here?
Did you guys see the video that the team account put out last year when everybody asked, or I guess all the players were asked, like, who's the hardest working guy on the team? And they, all these people answered Mike Danna, and then they showed Mike Danna the video of everyone saying that stuff about him. I don't know if you guys saw it. I would even maybe go back through tweets from last year, just trying to search for it, because it was a really special moment. Most of them talking about just like, this is a guy that always does things the right way. And he leads us on and off the field, really sets the tone in the film room and all these different things. And he got to watch all of his teammates say this stuff about him, and he teared up watching it, man. It was really cool content from the team. And I think it just says a lot that a guy that when he transferred to Michigan didn't necessarily do a whole lot. And Brendan Daly was the guy that was just absolutely in love with him and raved about him. And you know, Brendan Daly's still here, not coaching the position, I guess, but it seems like Danna was, to me, he felt like a guy that the team wanted to keep around because he's such a good culture fit. And he does all these different things that, that some of the other guys that we have on the team don't do. He really plugs a lot of different holes for them, or I guess checks a lot of boxes is maybe a better way to say it. But I'm thrilled, man. I think it's a really good contract for a really good guy.
Oh, for sure. Maddie Lane, I want to hear your opinions.
I mean, I think the deal's...
We appreciate you supporting KC Sports Network by listening to our podcast. You have helped us become the highest-ranked Chiefs podcast network in 2022 and 2023. And don't forget about our daily Substack newsletter, the best written analysis you can find on the Chiefs straight to your inbox every day. kcsn.substack.com.
Okay, I totally get why Briscoe
for
does
the
that.
Team that... You know, had a hole at defensive end that needed to put somebody. You guys got Kent to get me with this. This is good, but he knows the only reason he did this is because he knows I'm out on the lab for the next week and a half, because he knows how bad this gets for him if I'm there. He knows he doesn't want to start the war of pettiness. He knows how this goes. But no, I'm glad the Chiefs got this deal done. I think it's really good for the team. Not only is Danna a good player to have around, a good person, a good teammate for the locker room, I really think this kind of stuff matters. Like, we've all been looking at this team over the past couple weeks and like, wow, they just have not a lot of significant holes, but a lot of roster spots that are up for grabs. And bringing back a guy that we know can settle right into one of these spots that we're talking about, you know, a defensive end to start across from Karloftis, who can come in and play right away. Like, I think that's huge. So just getting the team set up on the right track as you head into the later parts of April, head into the draft, I think is big. And then the fact that it's Mike Danna, a guy that they are very familiar with. They know how he plays. He fits in really well with this team. Like, I think it all worked out really well. I was a little surprised, though. Like, it seems like there was a pretty healthy market for Danna out there, looking at the numbers, that they still had to, you know, creep up into. We'll see what the final structure is, but $8 million per year as a mid-April kind of signing, that seems to be right around what his projected market value was. I was a little surprised it was still that high for a mid-April signing.
Brad Spielbarger at PFF, he's done a really good job of estimating those contracts. The projected contract he had for Danna, 3 years, $8.25 million with $14.75 million guaranteed. So just a little bit under those numbers, you know, just kind of just a little bit under those PFF numbers, bringing back Mike Danna. Essentially what we've got, boys, is we have a run it back with the edge group. Obviously, I mean, and even Amenihue, it's run it back from 2023, and Charles Amenihue's missing the start of the season again. So, like, it's literally the same group, except for you're hoping for steps from a Felix Anudike Uzomah and George Karloftis to an extent. Malik Herring started to play well towards the end of the, you know, the season. You're kind of running last year's group back at defensive end. You're getting some continuity there. Do we think they're done? Do we think this is it at the edge group, Ryan?
You know, I want to give Maddie credit for saying pretty consistently, at least over the last month, that the Chiefs are probably not wanting to go from like 15% to, you know, 70% of the snaps for a guy like Felix. And so bringing Danna back, I think, really helps them with that. And in terms of maybe still adding bodies to that edge room, I think that there are a number of different players in this class that can do a lot of what Spags likes. The inside out guys, those kind of like edge tackle tweeners, if you will. I mean, you look at Darius Robinson, somebody that, you know, you guys actually even got to interview That's a dude to me that I think is an excellent scheme fit. And you might be sitting there at 32 and saying, like, he's just too good for us to pass up. And you go edge in the first round 3 years in a row.
Yeah, I think it's definitely a possibility, depending on like how the board breaks. I think we've seen this particular coaching staff and front office combination is not afraid to invest in that position group because it's a position group that they highly value. It's a position group that they think, you know, is going to play a big part. Now,
I just wrote about that in the KCSN draft or the KCSN Substack today. Actually, I kind of broke down the last 6 years of Brett Veach's draft history and how he's done and where he's put his draft capital. By the way, you can get 3 months to the KCSN Substack for free by purchasing, not pre-ordering. You can purchase the KCSN draft guide, which is what all the breaking news team stuff is brought to you by. You get 306 pages of Chiefs specific NFL draft content, and you also get 3 months to the Substack. The link is in the description of this show, I hope. But if not, go to gum.co/KCSN24, and that will get you the guide. Anyways, please continue, Matthew.
I don't know if that was supposed to be like another commercial interruption of me or not, because you kind of went into a whole thing. Like, I don't know what we're doing with that. That's a bad shrug. The one thing is Dana being a 3-year deal here, right? That's the one thing that would give me pause. I think the Chiefs are positioning themselves to feel like they not don't have to, but also like they don't need to be looking for another defensive end. I feel like that going with a longer term deal, which $13 million guaranteed for Dana, I think that means you're probably looking at least 2 years of him. I think that means that they're trying to position themselves in the draft that they're not needing to get somebody for the not only immediate, but the future at the defensive end spot. I think they're trying to open themselves up to spend their higher draft capital on the offensive side. Not that it's impossible. I just think the multi-year deal makes me start to think they would prefer to draft a different position besides defensive end. Whereas if it was a 1-year deal, I would think, you know, round one was still completely on the table.
I tend to believe that like round one's off the table personally. I think, you know, you've got capable bodies in there. You're looking at five, you know, for the home stretch for sure now, you know, that are for sure on the roster. And you still got a BJ Thompson that's trying to compete for a roster spot. The Chiefs held on to him for an entire season. So you know that they want to give him a good look. I mean, he was basically inactive for the entirety of the year, except for week 18, but they still held on to him because like they believe in the talent. They like the upside. They like what, you know, like they're liking something they're seeing worth giving him, you know, the entirety of the year on that roster. So I would be surprised a little bit with an early signing at defensive end, especially with as much as they spent now, but that's okay. I like this group that they've got in. I think Dana's just like, you hate saying it, but like he's an ultimate glue guy. Like he really is. He's a guy that he does the dirty work. He does what this team needs him to do. He does it with a good attitude, with great effort. And oh yeah, he was pretty productive this year too. Like people forget, like, you know, he set some career highs. So yeah, I love the move, man. I love the move. I'm glad he's here. I think this is it for that group. Do we have any like other pressing needs that like I'll ask you guys, do you have any other pressing needs that you think this team really has like before the draft, or like, do you feel relatively comfortable about this team where they're sitting? I mean, we talked a little bit about Donovan Smith as maybe an option, right? But I mean, outside of a Donovan Smith, like this team is relatively healthy from a roster construction perspective at this point. What do you think, Ryan?
I guess I'd agree to a certain extent. The one position that worries me as defensive tackle. That's a spot that, as you mentioned, it's basically the exact same room. I believe, could be wrong, but I believe the only person with a multi-year deal at that position is Chris Jones. Everybody else is on a 1 year. It's just a room that doesn't necessarily have much future or really even much of a ceiling. And because we use these guys in different spots, as we talked about the flexibility that they like on that line, I think they're able to negate some of those issues, but I would think that they probably want to go D tackle in the top 100.
Yeah, so guys, anyone watching right now, Kent did have to leave. He didn't, you know, he's out of here. He just said a little Irish goodbye to everybody, just slid on out. But yeah, I'm with Ryan here. I think the defensive tackle position, like, they have a lot of bodies, but you're looking at a group that we all spent last year kind of saying, like, man, they really could be a little bit better here. We'd want them to be a little bit better. And this offseason, and this is kind of what they've done for a lot of positions, but I think the defensive tackle position in particular, they didn't really bring it. Not only the floor didn't really go anywhere, the ceiling's not really going anywhere because it's all the same players. And outside of Tershawn Wharton, you probably don't see a lot of projection of improvement. A lot of these guys are veterans. They've been around here for a little while. You're not expecting a lot more. And they're all on 1 year. I think the only other guy that might be under contract for more than a year is Neil Farrell, who couldn't even be active, right, for the majority of last year. So that's another them, that position, offensive tackle. I do think that you could see another player added, or you would feel more comfortable with another player added before the draft. Obviously wide receiver, but I think at this point we are all kind of comfortable with that addition coming via the draft. I think everybody's kind of under the impression the Chiefs are going to probably draft a wide receiver in the top 100 picks in the draft or sign another veteran. And then at that point you kind of fill all the holes. I'm like, that's what I want to do. If I am controlling a team, you want to get all the holes filled going into the draft. And that's why this Danna signing was probably such a big deal for the team. And I think everybody should be excited about it.
Especially with the uncertainty that's connected to Charles Aminihu. I mean, I think it's a thing that we've kind of like tried to dismiss, hoping that the Danna signing would come. But not having Aminihu in the rotation until potentially like November, that's really what led you to talking about that huge jump in snaps for Felix. Yeah. Do you think, like, I'm sure there's going to be people that want to say the Chiefs had to re-sign Mike Danna because Felix isn't where he's supposed to be or whatever. Do you think that giving Mike Danna this contract even says anything about Felix? Because I don't. I think it just solidifies your rotation.
Yeah, I don't think it speaks anything about Felix's spot on the team, his development, or anything like that. I think it's just about, you know, protecting him, right? Like we said, this guy went from playing 15% of the snaps before the final week. You don't want to just throw him out there and have his only competition being B.J. Thompson, who also didn't play until that final week, or Malik Herring, who was, you know, at the very end of the rotation during the majority of the weeks. You want to give him somebody real that he has to earn reps away from. And so that's why I like bringing Danna back. I don't think it says anything negative whatsoever about Felix. Now, if the Chiefs also go out and spend a high draft pick at the edge position, then maybe you have to start to have that conversation a little bit. And I still don't think it's a guarantee, but at least then you bring it up a little bit. But right now, this is just a good pairing. Danna plays your early downs. He's a more of a run stopper. He's not going to give you a ton as a one-on-one pass rusher, but that's what you're hoping this extra time allows Felix to develop into his second year as this very young player who we all knew was developmental entering the NFL continues to grow.
Now, I don't want you to burn too much draft content here.
Oh,
but like, is there somebody, whether it's like a my guy from the draft guide, or maybe somebody that you feel like you haven't, maybe just like a forgotten guy in the class that you look at defensive tackle and say, I just think he's such a good fit for this team. And I really want to add him to the mix because he offers things that maybe the Chiefs don't currently have.
Yeah. And so the addition of Danna, this makes it a little bit, not more difficult, but like it makes it less pressing. So it's a little, you can kind of go any direction you want to with this now anywhere on the defensive line. Mm-hmm. A guy that I don't think Chiefs fans talk quite as much about right now is because Darius Robinson gets all this hype, gets all this talk. He's a Missouri player. Everyone's familiar with him. We got to talk to him, which also helps push him out there. Yeah. Brandon Dorlus, defensive lineman out of Oregon, kind of the same spot. He's a little bit of a tweener between a defensive end and a defensive tackle. I actually like him a little bit better as a D tackle. He plays better in a phone booth than I think he does out in space, but you want to bring him into this rotation. And while, you know, you probably got to work on adding weight to his body overall in the right way to play D tackle full time instead of be on the outside and inside, I think he would give the Chiefs another option as an interior pass rusher that they haven't really had along with Chris Jones. Like you think back, who's been the Chiefs' best interior rushers next to Chris Jones? It's been defensive ends kicking inside. Mm-hmm. Having somebody that can take some of the load off of Chris Jones of having to be that focal point of the interior rush, I think would be a good spot. And Dorlus is a guy that I think is flying under the radar of Chiefs fans just based on locality of Darius Robinson, a similar player.
I know you guys have talked a lot about Michael Hall too, because he's a top 30 guy for the Chiefs and that usually means something. he's like a pocket pusher too, a guy that's going to be able to be a pass rusher if that's a guy they end up selecting?
Yeah, so Michael Hall, yeah, another guy, a little bit undersized. I think he's weighing in like the 280s, 290s, but he played on the interior of Ohio State. If you go back to 2022, he actually did play a little bit D-end there before, you know, as trying to get used to that rotation. So he's another guy that I think is purely a D-tackle, but a pass rusher, not so much a run defender. And he's another guy that, yeah, would fit in well of that archetype, because we talked about it, the Chiefs have nose tackles on the roster. They're just all kind of pluggers, and none of them have really reached out and taken that job and ran with it. So I think a lot of people, de facto in their mind, they just immediately go, oh, the Chiefs want a nose tackle, they need a nose tackle, they don't have one. I don't know. I think another pass rusher on the interior might be just as important as that, you know, as the one tech, as your nose, because you don't want Chris Jones being stuck playing 80% of the snaps every single game, every single week going into this year 30, 31, 32 season.
Yeah. I look at the way they use Jones sometimes on those third downs and sliding him out to the edge. And usually at that point, they're in like NASCAR and all these guys are playing in different spots anyways. But I do think that maybe a lot of us would logically think if you move Chris Jones to an edge, you need someone at defensive tackle to step into that spot sometimes. And so that's a need that I think that they really could try to fill. Well, man, is there anything else that you wanted to touch on with Danna, or should we just get out of here and let everybody enjoy their Friday night?
I think we wrapped it up. You know, we're Friday night in the middle of most people's dinner time. The Chiefs decided to move up their news dump from 10:30 p.m. to 6:30 or 5:30, I guess, for those at Arrowhead time. But for those that joined a little late, we did just talk. Mike Danna re-signs with the Kansas City Chiefs for 3 years for $24 million. That includes $13 million guaranteed. We are about to get out of here, Brian. Just real quick, final thoughts on Mike Danna coming back on this three-year deal.
You know, before I saw the contract, the guy that I was comparing him to, somebody that you guys talked about as we were walking into free agency, was AJ Epenesa. They're from the same draft class, hence both being free agents. And Epenesa, I think, was either a late first or early second. And then Danna went in like the fifth or sixth round. I think it was pick 199. And so between these two guys, the sacks, the playing time, I mean, not necessarily play style, but like all of the data that people really look at was pretty even. And Epenesa got a 2-year, $12 million deal with like 8 guaranteed. And Danna got the extra year, right? And he got some more guaranteed money. And in many ways, I think that speaks to the Chiefs know who he is, and Buffalo maybe is still like trying to project what Epenesa can be for them. And so I really like where they're at. I was thinking that you might be able to get Danna a little bit cheaper than Epenesa because of the draft capital. But I think I really like what it says, that the Chiefs are investing in a guy that's really done his job. And I think he's earned every dollar of that contract already.
Yeah. And I'm pretty much right there with you, right? Like, I think, especially once we got into April and he wasn't signed, I thought he would come back to the Chiefs. My assumption was going to be a 1-year deal with a little bit of prove it money, or a kind of a prove it contract, because we're late in free agency period. Like, this isn't usually where a guy gets signed for roughly what his market value was, you know, projected to be. But then if you listen, like, you know, what Nate Taylor had tweeted out after the signing, there was a lot of teams that were still interested in Mike Danna, and he really wanted to come back to the Chiefs. That's where he preferred to be. So it took a little bit of time. The Chiefs had to get some money, but they brought him back. And like, yeah, the money is a little bit more than I would have anticipated the Chiefs spending over this time, because you're comparing him to, I think, with Epenesa, whether Danna or Epenesa has been better, but a guy like that, you see a little bit more upside with some other players that are making in this, you know, $6, $7, $8, $9 million per year range. Whereas Mike Danna is a lot more steady with maybe not as high of a ceiling, but for this team, it's exactly what they need. They have a little bit of money now because of the LeJarius Sneed trade. You don't win anything extra for saving that money. You just get a roll in the next year where you maybe do or don't get to spend it. So I think there might be some fans that quibble over the price, but I don't think it's worth it, because here's a guy that's going to come in. He's going to play starter reps for this team. He's going to do it well for what they ask him to do, and the team's better for it. So like, I'm happy Mike Danna's back. I think this sets them up a lot better for the draft coming up, for any other free agency moves they do or don't make for the rest of this time. So I know I'm happy he's back. I think you are too, Ryan, judging by what you were talking about earlier. So I think this is kind of a big win for the Chiefs all around.
Yeah. And now, Chiefs fans, you can just take a nap for about 3 weeks Can't imagine we're going to see much else between now and night one of the NFL draft. I'm sure we're going to be doing wall-to-wall 100% of the time that the draft is going live stream, featuring the guys from the Kansas City Laboratory right here back in our hometown in Kansas City. Right?
Man. Could start resting the throat already.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, no, I'm excited too. I gotta go load up on some cough drops and some honey, some teas. I gotta get myself ready. But yeah, nope, I'm excited. This was the breaking news team edition of Mike Danna re-signing with the Kansas City Chiefs for a 3-year, $24 million deal. We are going to get on out of here on this note, but thank you guys for joining us for this. The breaking news team is always going to be here with you guys. So if there is another signing, let's say next Friday, roughly around, I don't know, 6 p.m., where they bring back Donovan Smith, we will be here. We will be back for any signing the Chiefs make.
All right, good talking to you, Manny.
Later, bud. And... oh.